Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we're going to be talking about why no production vehicle has ever joined the 300 mile per hour club. And to do this we're going to be analyzing the Bugatti Veyron for a couple of reasons. First of all, it once did have the production top speed record, and second of all, there's a lot of data out there available for it. The Bugatti Chiron would be great to analyze, but not all of the data is out there yet. So looking at the Bugatti Veyron, it has a drag coefficient when it's in top speed mode lowered down of 0.36. This is versus 0.41 with a top speed of 230 miles per hour when it's not in this top speed mode. Frontal area of 2.07 meters squared or 22.3 feet squared. Weight of 1888 kilograms or 4,162 pounds. So the first thing we're going to do is find out how much power does this vehicle need to overcome aerodynamic drag in order to reach 300 miles per hour. Power is equal to force times velocity. So if we find the force of drag, multiply that by 300 miles per hour, that will give us how much power we need to overcome aerodynamic drag alone. That's equal to 1/2 rho, which is the density of air. At sea level, this is 1.225 kilograms per meter cubed at 15 degrees Celsius. Multiply that by velocity squared times our drag coefficient, 0.36. Multiply that by our frontal area, and then multiply that once again by velocity. So I've changed the velocity here from miles per hour or from kilometers per hour to 134.112 meters per second. Now, you know, you may also be wondering, you know, what's the equivalent of 300 mile per hour club in the metric system, 483? I'm sure a lot of you out there have wondered, you know, why has no car ever hit 483 kilometers per hour? And that's what this video is about. Great. So we do that math, we get 1.101 megawatts or 1,476 horsepower. That's how much horsepower we will need just to overcome aerodynamic drag. Now moving on, power to overcome rolling resistance, we need once again force times velocity. So the force of rolling resistance is equal to the coefficient of rolling resistance multiplied by the normal force and then multiplied by our velocity to get power. Now, this is using a conservative high estimate of 0.015 as the coefficient of rolling resistance for a tire. I'm just kind of assuming it's a sticky tire that has high rolling resistance. Multiplying that by 1888, that's the mass of the vehicle, times 9.81 meters per second squared, times our top speed of 300 miles per hour, or 134 meters per second. That gives us 37.26 kilowatts, or about 50 horsepower, which we'll need just to overcome rolling resistance. So we can add those two together, and we will know that at the wheels, we will need 1,526 horsepower. And so here's where we get into some bad math, admittedly. We're just going to assume a 15% power loss through the drivetrain. Now, this will be different for every single vehicle, and really the only way to find this out is to dyno your specific engine and then dyno your specific vehicle at the wheels separately. Then you can determine, you know, how much power did you lose through the drivetrain. That's really the only way to do it. It's going to be unique to every single vehicle. Using 15% as a general rule is dumb. However, I have included a link in the video description which goes into great detail about where all of those power losses occur and kind of general percentages. Gets into, you know, very fine detail of where this power loss comes from, this 15%, depending on the vehicle. So worth checking out. I'll put that in the video description. And so if you take 1526 divided by 0.85, assuming a 15% power loss, that's going to give us about 1800 horsepower, which we're going to need at the engine, or 1.34 megawatts at the engine in order to reach 300 miles per hour. Okay, now some of the information that comes from this link, which I'll be referencing in the video description, is, you know, how much power is actually generated by the engine, how much power of that is completely wasted. So one of the figures Bugatti has, you know, said about the Chiron is that although it produces 1500 horsepower, it has about 3000 horsepower that it needs to reject via heat. And so, you know, this is done primarily through two methods. You've got a cooling system for your engine, and then you, of course, have the exhaust. Your exhaust is just spitting out heat. Hopefully you recover that. That's a great thing about turbochargers, can help recover some of that energy. And then you, of course, have the cooling system to reject that heat. So when you're driving a vehicle that has this much power, you need a lot of cooling because, you know, 3,000 horsepower of heat is no joke. And so part of the reason why this has such a crappy drag coefficient, it's actually extremely impressive. You just don't realize it because, you know, it looks the exact same as a Cadillac Escalade. Cadillac Escalade has a drag coefficient of 0.36. So does a Bugatti Veyron in top speed mode. The reason why this is so high and why this one isn't, you know, this actually isn't that good for an Escalade. This is extremely good for a Chiron. Okay, it is still okay. Like, I shouldn't bash them. They certainly know what they're doing. But the point is, you're going to have a significant amount of drag just because of cooling when you have engines this powerful. So you've got all of these, you know, different ports on there. The Bugatti Veyron has something like 10 radiators, 10 heat exchangers. And so you've got all these air ports on your vehicle to be able to suck in that air. And sucking in that air and passing it through these heat exchangers creates a lot of drag. And so that's why it has this drag coefficient of 0.36. So if you could lower this, you could reach that top speed with significantly less power, but it's very difficult to do. So you could theoretically create a production vehicle that doesn't have adequate cooling, which has a very low drag coefficient and could get to 300 miles per hour with far less than 1800 horsepower. But it would probably overheat and it wouldn't last very long, and you wouldn't want to put a warranty on that vehicle because it's going to overheat and it's going to fail. So cooling is one of the biggest reasons, one of the biggest drawbacks of reaching 300 miles per hour, is because you have to have enough airflow for cooling your vehicle while simultaneously enough power to reach that top speed. So those kind of battle against each other. And another important thing to mention is tires. So the Veyron used special Michelin Sport 2 tires. They need to be perfectly balanced, so you don't have any vibrations at these ridiculously high speeds. And they need to be able to hold together, you know, maintain the shape, maintain their contact patch on the ground at extreme G's. And an example, you know, an extreme example is the Bloodhound SSC, which uses aluminum wheels. There's no rubber on it. They're going for the land speed record. Not a good idea for road cars because you don't really have any traction with an aluminum wheel. But if you're just going in a straight line, it's smart to do because an aluminum wheel will hold together, whereas the rubber at those G-forces that it's experiencing is just going to kind of shred apart. So hopefully this has been interesting. My prediction is that we won't see a car reach 300 miles per hour until, you know, it's going to have at least 1800 horsepower. It could be less, you know, depending on aerodynamic drag. This is the big critical part here, is getting aerodynamic drag down. That dictates this horsepower for the most part. As you can see, 1500 horsepower alone is just overcoming aerodynamic drag. So if we can lower that drag coefficient, we can get in below 1800 horsepower. But as I mentioned, cooling drag is playing a huge role here because there's so much heat to reject. So thank you guys for watching. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below.